History with Young America's Foundation, starting all the way back in 1991, when the young Marc Short and a few other students organized an event with 1,700 students in attendance at Washington and Lee University as a rally in support of our armed forces and victory in the Persian Gulf. The rally garnered so much attention that President George H.W. Bush wrote a letter in support, calling it a wonderful way to stand in solidarity with our brave servicemen and women who are taking part in the liberation of Kuwait. I am grateful that our troops face the challenges before them, knowing that they have the steadfast support and heartfelt prayers of millions of people like you. This same year, Marc was awarded a summer internship with Young America's Foundation, an experience which Marc would later credit to helping him to develop his own conservative philosophy. Upon graduation in 1992, Marc joined the YAF staff as national director and soon became the YAF conference co-director. In 1993, Marc, as YAF national director, organized events all over the country, including a series of lectures that were a huge success, drawing, for instance, more than 1,000 Florida State students to hear from Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North. Marc continued in the role of national director with Young America's Foundation into 1995 and eventually was hired as the executive director of the Freedom Alliance. In 1998, Marc returned to Young America's Foundation, this time as the executive director of a brand new effort by the foundation, Saving the Reagan Ranch. He and his wife, Kristen, were the first YAF leaders on the ground full-time in Santa Barbara, California. Marc held this position at the ranch until the year 2000, at which time he returned to his native state of Virginia to pursue his master's degree at the Darden School of Business at UVA. After completing his UVA degree, Marc served in numerous positions, including spokesman for the Department of Homeland Security, a job working for then-Congressman Mike Pence, chief of staff for the House Republican Conference, and president of Freedom Partners. Then in 2017, he was appointed by President Donald Trump as assistant to the president and White House Director of Legislative Affairs. In February of 2018, Political assessed Marc's first year as, quote, Trump's top liaison to Congress, says he's been a critical figure in some of the White House's most important successful endeavors, including the confirmation of a slew of federal judges and the automatic rollback of regulations under the Congressional Review Act. In 2019, Marc joined Vice President Mike Pence's team as his chief of staff. There are many, many graduates of Young America's Foundation who have gone on to serve in key roles in our movement and have accomplished so much for our cause. Marc is a shining example of this and a great role model for all of students with us today in our ranks across the country. Joining Marc today is Madison Habersetzer, who serves as program officer with Young America's Foundation at the Reagan Ranch. Madison helps equip students with the resources and skills they need to effectively defend conservative values on campus and to inspire more students to stand up for freedom. She is a graduate of Whitworth University, where she served as the chair of her YAF chapter and joined the team at the foundation in 2019. Please join me in welcoming Marc Short and Madison Habersetzer.
Thank you so much, Mackie, for that introduction, and thank you, Marc, for being here with us today. So the first question that I want to start off with you today is regarding your experience at the Reagan Ranch. Of course, when we first acquired the Reagan Ranch in 1998, Young America's Foundation was just a conservative educational organization based out of Virginia. So it was a pretty bold move for us to go ahead and purchase a historic presidential property all the way in California, and you spearheaded that project. Can you tell us a little bit about your early days at the ranch and why you think it's so important for students today to still see the Reagan Ranch?
Well, Madison, thank you. Thanks for having me here. And before I begin, can I just ask you guys, I know it's Friday, you guys have had a great week. Can you give a round of applause to Jolie and Madison and all the staff here to put this together? Thank you. I say that as somebody who ran this conference many, many years ago and really impressed with how much it's grown and the staff at Young America's and what y'all have accomplished. So congrats on being here this week, and I hope you've learned a lot. Madison, I think that, you know, at that time, the previous president of Young America's Foundation, Ron Robinson, had a vision to protect the ranch because he had read story actually in the Wall Street Journal that it talked about how the president's property had at one point been attempted for a federal effort to take it over and to preserve it. And then that had failed. in many cases, people said, Ronald Reagan, the last thing he would want is for American taxpayers to be subsidizing his property and its preservation for future generations. But then there'd been an effort in the California state legislature to do the same, and that effort had fallen short as well. And Ron had the vision to say, well, why don't we at Young America's Foundation, who feel so connected to Ronald Reagan, acquire the property and turn it into a facility where students can learn more about his legacy? And he offered my wife, Kristen, and I the opportunity to go out there as newlyweds to help launch the program. And I think our first couple of years in many cases were devoted to really fundraising and making sure that donors, we could pay off the note on the property and begin the process. But never in our wildest dreams could we have seen all that Young America's has accomplished there over the years. And Madison has shared with me that they have upcoming conferences that still have availability for you guys. And if there are people here who have not yet been, I really strongly encourage you to, because it's a unique setting in which you can learn more about the president. What I think shocks most people is how humble it is. And yet, while it's majestic setting on top of the San Ysidro Mountains, the reality is that the home is 1,500 square feet with no central air, no central heat. And it's just an amazing testament to the president's humility and how he really didn't need the trappings and surroundings of the White House, and how much he really actually enjoyed getting out of Washington and being back with people and having that sort of a retreat. And I think so many historic events happen there, but it also is a reflection into his philosophy of really not wanting all those trappings of the presidency, and I think wanting to serve the American people in his role as president.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for helping us get that project started. It's been such a privilege for me and many of my colleagues to continue the work that you began at the Reagan Ranch. And it's always amazing to share it with students, like all these wonderful young leaders among us. So thank you. You have a really impressive resume, not only in government, but also with YAF. You've started as a YAF activist on your own campus back in the day, and we have many YAF activists with us here at NCSC in Houston, Texas. We have many YAF chairmen among us, as well as individual members. And if you could tell us a little bit about how YAF prepared you for your career, and particularly propelled you into the position you found yourself in 2016 in the White House.
Well, I had a great opportunity to be involved at Young America's Foundation at an early age, and I know there's a couple Washington and Lee students here I look forward to getting to talk to after this. But at the time at WNL, I think that I was involved. You heard Mackie talk about the rally we did, but we also were very involved in a lot of campus activism, because it was a school that had a very conservative student body, but a more and more progressively liberal faculty administration. So there was a lot of tension there. And I think the Young America's Foundation provides you an opportunity to learn so much. I know that a lot of my activities were spent outside of the classroom, and my GPA reflected that. But I learned so much more in a lot of the campus activism of basically bringing organizations together, having onto the campus so people could get a balance in what they're hearing outside the classroom, or whether it was organizing a student publication and having to raise the funds to make sure that you could pay for the publication, the printing and distribution. I know that that's a lot easier today with electronic publications, but just those life lessons were so important. And so I credit Young America's a lot with that. And I think the thing it did is, once I became a staff member, is they afforded you great responsibilities at very early ages. And I think it forces you to kind of step up into leadership roles and to begin to lead young people and hopefully to advance our conservative movement.
Wonderful. Being a young leader on campus, of course, has its challenges, especially when being a conservative, we're often the minorities on campus. And I know our students face a lot of opposition and pushback on campus. What's a word of advice that you could give them to encourage them in their fight for conservatism on campus? And something perhaps that you wish someone had told you when you were a young activist?
You know, I think it's harder for you guys today. I think that one of the things that I look back on and recognize candidly was all the mistakes I made as a young activist, and probably the fights that we took on. And I reflect back and say, you know, a little bit later with a little more maturity, I probably wouldn't have said the things I said or done it exactly the way I did. And today, with electronic media, and I think the effort in social media to try to make news and to sort of create an edge, I think, complicates a lot of the campus battles because there's a greater interest for that sort of pugilistic battle, when in many cases what we're advocating for is common sense conservative values that we think deserve a merit and a balance on campus. And so I think it's harder because I think colleges should be an opportunity for you to learn and make mistakes. And I made more than my fair share of them. And that's really the environment you should be learning in. And you should be formulating your own opinions. And it's, you know, it was that campus environment that formulated so many of the foundations for the conservative views that I hold today. And so I guess my encouragement to you would be to recognize this is your window for you guys to be exploring all the different viewpoints across the conservative movement. And I think one of the benefits of Young America's Foundation is you could be here as a traditional conservative, you could be here as more of a populist conservative, but having this environment which you can air those discussions and viewpoints openly is really what the college experience should be about. And so having this environment to do that and form your own opinions is really what's greatest.
Continuing with the topic of campus activism and leadership, what do you think is the most pressing issue facing conservatives today, and how can young people push back on campus?
I think along the same lines, let me ask you guys a question. How many of you today get your news from cable news? Right. Yeah. So, you know, for my parents, there was a network news. And for my generation, I think we still watch cable news. But I'm always fascinated how few people in your generation get their news that way. And I think that is an advancement and a positive development for a lot of us because the media has been so biased for so long. And as you see basically a decentralization of where people get their news, there's a lot of places you can find it. But I think the challenge is, in many cases, those news sources are not going to be the most reliable. And so there's both the excitement that you decentralize the news that had been so biased, but at the same time, you now are having an extra step of learning, if you find some piece of information, is it really reliable? Is it really true? And I think the biggest challenge you guys have is to take the extra step of not just receiving the information, but discerning, I need to study this and determine whether this is really the right viewpoint or not. And I think that's a challenge. It's a good challenge to have, but I think it's a challenge for a lot of people in our movement today because, unfortunately, I think that there's a lot of information that comes through different channels that is less reliable.
Thank you. We'll move on a little bit to your time at the White House. I'm sure you learned a lot over your time working very closely with both Vice President Mike Pence and President Trump, and I'd love to hear a little bit more about those experiences. Can you tell us a little bit about specifically working with Mike Pence? We heard from him here just two nights ago. He spoke to us and serves as our Ronald Reagan Presidential Scholar here at the Foundation, so he's become a really important leader in our movement, as I'm sure you would agree. And can you tell us about what's the most important lesson you learned while working on his staff?
Well, I was very blessed to have the chance to serve him a couple times when I worked for House Republicans. And what I learned from Mike most essentially, I think, is to have a servant's heart in those roles. And what I mean by that is that he had a set of rules for our staff. There was four of them. It was pretty basic. But it was... And to have a servant's heart in the job that you do. And I think that last one was really central to us coming together as a team and working to advance all Republicans. And it was that cycle in 2010 that we won 63 seats, more than any single midterm election ever for House Republicans to gain seats. And I think that that's a culture that we tried to instill in the Vice President's office as well, was really one of having a servant's heart. And I think that as you guys graduate from college and move on to your next opportunities, my best advice to you would be to find, in the jobs you seek, find the culture that fits you and where you want to be a part of. Because as we advance that within the Vice President's office of really truly having a servant's heart to serve the president, but also to serve the American people that elected the Vice President and President of those roles, I think it helped to create a continuity among our staff that I think unfortunately was missing in many cases on the President's staff. And I think it created a continuity of service that enabled us to accomplish a lot enabled us to have less drama, but also I think it created a camaraderie that is something that made it a fun place to work. And I think, you know, having the models of honoring God, having fun, and having a servant's heart just creates an environment you want to find more people like that who want to be a part of your effort.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing. I know it was such a privilege for all of us to hear from him the other night and you now today. So I think we'd probably like to hear some stories about behind the scenes in the Trump administration. What do you all think? Do you have any stories you can tell us about your time working with President Trump?
You know, I think that you've heard from several of our team here this week, and I think that history hopefully records is looking back at all that was accomplished. There was obviously so much chaos in the system that I think the media wanted to focus on. But when you look back and say you passed record tax achievements, I think the largest tax cuts since the Reagan tax cuts, and in some cases, the Reagan tax cuts are more on the personal side, the Trump tax cuts more on the corporate side, but still huge relief that I think created millions of new jobs, 7.5 million new jobs in just a couple of years, lowest unemployment ever for African Americans, lowest unemployment ever reached for Hispanic Americans and Asian Americans. When you look at nearly 300 conservative judges, I think that's going to be one of the hallmarks of the Trump presidency and a record of that's going to live for generations to come of reestablishing, hopefully, judges that adhere to our constitutional principles. Three Supreme Court justices, resetting trade negotiations. Robert, in our last discussion, talked about some of the accomplishments on the foreign policy front, eliminating Soleimani, al-Baghdadi, changing the discussion in the Middle East with Iran. I think changing the discussion of how we address China across the world stage in ways that we've actually boxed in Democrats that they can't have the similar appeasement now. I think it's too hard to go back. There's so many things that were accomplished those 4 years that I think gave us great pride. You know, Madison asked if I had any sort of more entertaining stories. Some of those I can't tell with the camera on, but you know, I remember one of my first insights into the president's ability to communicate with the American people was, you guys may not remember this, in 2016, there was a very famous play called Hamilton that was a sellout on Broadway. Any of you guys see Hamilton? Okay, so you guys know it. That transition time, right after we'd won in 2016, we were convening at Bedminster, the president's residence, to discuss cabinet picks and personnel choices. And the vice president had taken his family to see Hamilton. And as many of you may recall, there was a dust up because after the performance, the actors sort of made a political statement in, I think, trying to gain attention and chastise some of the vice president's biblical views on family. And they sort of made a big scene. It became a big press story. So we were convening for dinner that evening at Bedminster, and the president asked Mike, said, well, what was it like? And he said, it was, you know, typical Hollywood or Broadway thing, dust up, but it was fine. He said, the show was actually really good. Family enjoyed it. We had a good time. The president said, well, I don't really like the news coverage of it. Mike's like, it's fine. It really was. Don't worry about it. It's good. He said, I don't know about that. He pulls out his phone. Starts to type, and he says, the highly overrated Hamilton mistreated the vice president tonight on Broadway, and I think that they owe him an apology, blah, blah, blah. But it was my first real insight to the way that he could capture a news moment and make it, you know, step himself into the middle of that debate in ways that I think the American people, they didn't have a filter, the news media. They knew directly what he was thinking at that moment. And so it was an insight for me about how many cases the next 4 years would go, because in my job as head of legislative affairs director, when I woke up at 5:30 and 6 in the morning, the first thing I would do is check my phone to kind of know how the rest of the day would go.
I I know we have a lot of students in the room with political aspirations, people with a dream of one day making it into politics, making it into the White House. Is there any advice that you would give for young, ambitious leaders who are hoping to get their foot in the door in the political sphere?
You know, I guess my advice would be to keep a check on the ambition and instead look at it as service. I think that public service is a great honor. And I think that every morning that I got to drive into the White House, it was just an enormous honor to feel like you're serving the American people in those roles. And so if you're truly motivated by saying, here are viewpoints that I have and I think that are underrepresented, and I can serve my constituents and the voice of the American people, that's a great calling. But I think that too often we have people in D.C. who are driven by ambition, and it's about them, and it's about attention for them as opposed to ways that they can serve their constituents. So if you feel like you're called to do it, it's a great honor, and it's a great thing to be able to serve the American people in either Congress or serving in staff roles up there or in the White House. But I hope it's motivated by saying, here's true convictions that we have and what we're feeling called to do.
Of course, President Trump and Mike Pence are both wonderful examples of public servants, and I think another great example of someone who really saw public office as a way to serve America and serve fellow Americans was President Ronald Reagan. And I was wondering if you have any favorite stories, memories, things you admire of President Reagan that you'd be willing to share with us today.
You know, I think I'm old, but I'm not quite old enough to have been a voter when Reagan was elected. But I think that I always cherish the chance that Kristen and I had to actually meet the president. At that point, you know, he had announced to the world his affliction with Alzheimer's and was a few years advanced into that. And just having the opportunity to go down to visit him in his office, he looked just as strong as he always had, and he was just as kind. Our conversation was kept at a pretty surface level, but it was just a unique and awesome experience for me.
Wonderful. Well, students, we have time for some questions. If you would like to get in line, we can go ahead and take a few of your questions.
I really want to make this as much accessible to y'all's time as possible. I know, as having run this conference, it's Friday. You've been in those seats for 5 days. I'm sure you've had some awesome speakers, but I said to Madison, can we do this in a way where it's interactive and less about me sort of preaching to y'all and hopefully having this more as a Q&A. So please step up to the mics. I'd love to get your questions and be as accessible as I can.
Sit on. Hi there. My name is Danny. I go to UW-Wisconsin Oshkosh. And my question is, what's the biggest challenge for you from a religious perspective going into a place like Washington, D.C., where it can often be perceived from the outside world and might actually be the case to be a not so religious place in the world?
Well, thanks for the question. I think that I think that believers have many challenges, whether or not it's in Washington, D.C., or going to work in private sector and holding true to your beliefs. But I don't know that it's any more significant in D.C. I know that's hard to believe sometimes because of the way the press covers Washington. But I think that there are a lot of, fortunately, we have a lot of people in Washington who share, I think, many of our Judeo-Christian values, who are called to, for the right reason, to serve. And if you find them, it could be a great calling and a great job. So there's no doubt that we live in a culture today that has animus, unfortunately, to many Judeo-Christian views. But I think that you find that there's some of the same challenges in worlds outside of politics. So I would just encourage, if you're feeling that that's a place you want to go, don't be deterred. Just find those people who share those worldviews.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Marc Useche, and I go to Loyola Chicago. My question to you is, when did you start, and what was your specific call to go into public service and to serve this nation as a public servant by working in the White House? And my question is, you know, later, you know, how can you tell young students like us whether we should seek, you know, public office by running or towards the other side of public offices, which there's many opportunities as well, because I feel like, you know, I have a duty to serve this nation because this nation has done a lot for me as an immigrant. I mean, if I could, I would even run for president, but I can't constitutionally, but because I'm in the middle of deciding where I want to go into, like, you know, the candidacy, you know, run for Senate, run for governorship, or just go and work, you know, on the other backhand of government, which I think does a lot of help for this country.
Well, thanks for the question. You know, I guess for me, I think Mackie said in the introduction that after my tenure at the Reagan Ranch, you know, I was at that point 30 years old and said, how can I beat this? Like, I got to be more or less a chief of staff for Ollie North, and then I got to be director of the Reagan Ranch at a young age, and it was like, I want to go do something else. So I went back to MBA school thinking it was my pathway out of politics. And my wife loved the notion of $100,000 in student loans for that MBA education for me to go back and take a government job. But I think that, you know, what I learned there, as much as I loved being in school, at MBA school at University of Virginia, was that my calling wasn't politics. And it wasn't something to retreat from. It's just like, being exposed to other things, I realized that's where my passion was. And so that was a really important lesson for me to learn and to stay focused in that area. And I think from then on, you know, I've been incredibly blessed by doors that the Lord opened. There's no way I could have foreseen the hopscotch in my career. You know, before I was Mike Pence's chief of staff, I was chief of staff for Kay Bailey Hutchison, senator from Texas. And, you know, I got that job without any Hill experience. And I remember asking her one day, you know, well, why did you choose me? Because in the Senate, your staffs are different. In the House, every staff's the same. In the Senate, the bigger states have bigger staffs. And she was in leadership. And so with no Hill experience, sort of parachuting into that role was an incredibly fortuitous event. And she was like, well, Mark, you know, there's a lot of lawyers up here, but nobody else has an MBA. And I'm sitting thinking, like, I had no idea why I went to MBA school, open these doors. And so, you know, I think that hopefully being prayerful and where you want to be and where you and just asking the Lord to open the right doors and to close the doors so he doesn't want you to enter is the best possible advice I can give you.
Hello, my name is Kennedy Pulowski, and I am attending Utah Valley University. I have a two-part question for you. The first part is, I love what you said about being a public servant. Do you have any examples of people who have that public servant heart in the interactions that you had in political office, or I guess in the political realm? And then the second part is, to your knowledge, did President Trump ever invite anyone to go get a spray tan with him?
On the first question, I think, as I shared, I think that Mike Pence is the person I think most embodies that. And that's why I really felt, you know, honored to work for him on Capitol Hill. And to your last question, you know, about why did I decide to join the ticket, it was when Trump tapped Pence to be his vice presidential ticket that I joined that effort in 2016. So he's somebody that I certainly hold up as representing that true servant's heart. I was also fortunate, I mentioned, you know, that I had a chance to work for Ollie North early in my career. And Ollie is somebody who I truly credit as helping to bring me to faith. And I, you know, I was the young 20-something year old who would barge into his door in his office and say, you know, here's some Christ Colonel, multiple Bronze Stars, Silver Star, in prayer with fellow men, you know, arms around each other, holding each other accountable. And it began to change my mind to say, you know, I have this, what a Christian is, but it's a really distorted vision. And seeing this Lieutenant Colonel, incredibly decorated in the way he lived out his faith, began to make me question things in my life and made me to grow to accept Christ as my Savior. And I think that was so those are two people that I really look up to who I think had that servant's heart. Many times there are people that I've been disappointed to believe one thing when I saw them, you know, at a distance on Capitol Hill, and perhaps then when I had the opportunity to work with them in the White House, began to see a different side and became disappointed in some of those. So I don't know. I don't have a magic, you know, way to say here's how you can separate. I think that we just need to live out our lives as believers and leave the judgment to others. But I think we have to just do our job in helping to serve our higher calling in public service.
Thank you.
I'm Gaznav Lutumba from Northern Kentucky University. When I hear the left, Democrats, they always talk about income inequality in America, but they do really nothing to reduce income inequality. So if you read the book of The Price of Inequality by Professor Stiglitz, he's blaming two things for income inequality in America: the financial system and corporate America. And he's proposing some amazing solution to reduce income inequality. And it's exactly what you did with President Trump. Joseph Stiglitz says, if you want to reduce income inequality, you need to cut the tax, lower the tax for corporates so they can bring jobs to America and create more jobs here. And we saw that during the Trump administration. Our bank accounts was like booming all the time. And life starts to get better. But the left, who show themselves as they care about people, they do nothing to reduce income inequality. I don't know, do you have, apart from the tax cuts, do you have another better way to reduce income inequality? And what advice can you give to the left on reducing income inequality that they always talk about without doing nothing?
Great, good questions. Let me try and answer this in two different ways. One, the question is about income inequality, and I think that you saw the income inequality gap grow largest during the Obama years. And in many cases, you're coming out of the financial collapse. And so when all of a sudden you have a monetary policy that is 0% interest rates, who are the people that can take advantage of that? It's the people who have the ability to get enormous loans and to continue to have to incur debt because they're not going to have, there's not a substantial amount that they're paying off. People with assets are able to benefit from those policies more than those who are living off paycheck to paycheck. The Trump tax cuts, actually, the people that benefited the most on a percentage of their income were those in the middle class because they had a greater percentage of tax relief than those at the top percentages. I think it's a challenge to overcome the way the media distorts the income inequality question. But I also would ask you guys, should our goal be income equality or equal opportunity? So I think the Democrats have failed on the income inequality, even though they preach it. But I would ask you, should our message be to try to compete at that level or to say what we're doing as free market conservatives is advocating that everybody should have equal opportunity and it's not the government's job to try to create income inequality?
Thank you.
Hi, sir. I'm Troy from Normandale College, and I sure could use some mean tweets instead of a president falling up the stairs nowadays. My question is, do you think that President Trump should go back to Twitter or should get on Getter, or what do you think he should do as far as getting on social media again?
I don't know, Troy. I'm not probably the best one to advise him on that. I think that his social media, his policy on social media probably confounded me in a lot of ways. I felt that in many cases we would have a successful news story that would be stepped on by some social media tweet. But at the same time, he's the one that used it in ways that I think shocked a lot of Americans to his victory in 2016. So I can't sit here in judgment of it because things that I think would be like, why are you tweeting that out today? I think it worked in a lot of ways to American people to know what he was thinking in exactly the moment in 2016. So I don't know that I'm the best one to pass judgment on what that Twitter policy should be. I think that in 2016, the American people wanted a fighter, and that's what they got to see. And I think that that he delivered on so many of those promises over the course of the 4 years in the ways that he was fighting for them. But I also candidly think, Troy, sometimes your greatest strength can, you know, in a mirror be also weakness. And I think that in many cases, some of the data that I've seen from 2020 was a lot of voters who accepted, I'm so thankful for these policies, but exhaustion from some of the chaos of the constant tweets. So I sit here acknowledging I think it led to his victory in 2016, but I wouldn't be the best one to advise him on where he should go for social media outlets. I don't think the president's going to lack any vehicle to get attention. He's going to continue to get that. So whether he's on Twitter or different vehicles, I suspect he'll continue to get plenty of coverage.
Howdy, Cassie May, University of North Texas. So I am madly in love with Jesus and what he's done for me. And I think too often we ask people, what are the struggles? What is the backlash you've gotten for being a Christian or sharing the gospel? But I wanted to hear from you, what is one of the most positive experiences you've had where you've gotten to share the gospel, have gotten to share your faith, and just either hearts were changed or they just such a positive response?
You know, I'd say that in the vice president's office, we would begin every staff meeting in prayer. And I just think it was the right tone. I can't sit here and tell you of one of those environments where I felt like there was some magical, you know, transformation. But I can tell you, I think that we sought counsel and wisdom in that office as much as we could. And I think it set the right environmental tone for our team in ways that I think attracted the people who would fit our culture the best. So I'll think about the question a little bit more. Maybe we can catch up after this. But I think that probably just making sure that we were consistent in calling on him for counsel in that position was probably the thing that sustained us, because those jobs are long and full of stress. And I think much of that stress in the final chapter of the administration has been well chronicled. But I think that seeking his wisdom was certainly helpful to all of us.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, Michael Wolf, University of Michigan. Thanks for being with us today. I wanted to ask, as somebody who's an alumni of a very influential member of the House, Mike Pence, chair of the House Republican Conference, and then somebody who was the chief congressional liaison for President Trump, what is the biggest challenge working as liaison between Congress and the executive and the legislative branch?
It may not surprise you that legislative affairs director of President Trump is probably different than a legislative affairs director of other presidents. So I would answer my experience, and it's probably not a general one.
Right.
I think that President Trump wanted to be actively involved in all aspects of Hill outreach. And I think that for a lot of our staff in the legislative affairs office who had worked for President Bush or had served in similar roles on Capitol Hill, there was sometimes a frustration of like, you know, I had talked to Chairman so-and-so and I'd agreed to this. And now apparently the president had a call with him last night and he's changed his mind. What do I do with that? And I think what we had to do was step back and say, you know, we heard from so many people in the previous, when we came in the job, that President Obama was often detached from Congress and their staff couldn't get the same interaction. I said, we have an enormous opportunity. This president's enormously engaged and he wants to be. So our challenge is to make sure that we don't get wedded to feeling like, hey, this is our role. Instead, it's to say, let's make sure that we have somebody who's as well-informed as possible, because if he wants to be doing the direct negotiations, then let's make sure that that's used an asset to our team as opposed to a detriment. So that was probably one of the biggest changes. And as I said, sometimes you could have a position change with a 6 a.m. tweet that then we would have to follow and catch up to. But I think that for us, that was one of the biggest challenges, kind of reset the framework of people's opinions.
So you think a heavily involved president can be a terrible, can be a bad and good thing, depending if...
Absolutely. It depends. I don't think there's a right necessarily model. I think it depends on the personality of the president, and you have to make it work to your advantage.
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah.
Hello, I'm Miles Korn from Thomas Aquinas College. And given that so much of D.C. is driven by ambition for money and power, and there's a lot of corruption in D.C., as is well known, How can we bring actual service based on good character to DC, big government, and really actually serve the American people?
Well, Miles, I think the answer is kind of embedded in the question. I think the way to change it is for good people to put themselves forward to serve. And I think that, you know, I hope many of you are called to do that in this room, because that's the best way to begin to impact the community that currently is there. And look, I think that our founders were so wise in so many ways, and people get frustrated and say, you know, DC is broken, things aren't getting done. Well, I think our founders created a system that was very intentional to not allow a lot of things to get done. And I think they didn't trust, you know, the human nature in a lot of ways. And they created a system that constrained it. And so so we're very fortunate that we live in the representative democracy that has so many checks and balances that it does. But you're right. I mean, we need to have people of good, sound moral character willing to serve. And I think that right now there's probably a greater draw for people who are not motivated by the right reasons because of much of the attention that comes with those roles. So we need good young people to step up and be willing to serve.
Thank you. Yeah.
Hi, Marc. My name is Alejandro Flores over at Fresno City College. Huge fan. I've been following you for quite a long time. My question is a little bit, not sure if it's too personal, but so following January 6th, news reports were out that you were barred from the White House. I'm just interested in, like, how is your relationship now with President Trump, and like, how was your reaction following like the notice that you were kicked out?
You know, after January 6th that night, I'd seen press reports that I'd been banned from the White House. It was about 3:50 a.m. that the vice president left the Capitol. And at that time, I went back to the White House and went back to my office. And there was no ban or bar. I think that I continued to go in daily from then on. And the president made it clear to the vice president a few days later that I was not banned or barred. Mm-hmm. The best information I have is the president, I think, was frustrated on January 6th, as is well chronicled, that we'd come to a different position about what the vice president's authority was. And I think he exclaimed that in a manner of frustration, because I think some staff had said, you know, that Marc had an outsized role in informing the vice president's opinion here. But, you know, I think that I hope that as we get further and further from that day, that many of you and others will step back and say, really, there's hardly anything more un-American than the notion that any one person would be vested with that much authority, that he or she could unilaterally decide which electors to accept or reject. And I think that for those who believe that the vice president had some extraordinary power bestowed upon him that no vice president ever used in 250 years of our republic, I think would be reluctant to know or believe that Kamala Harris would have the same authority in 2024 to unilaterally decide which electors she wants to accept or reject. And so we had expended a lot of time in researching this and what the vice president's role was. And as I said, I believe our founders were very wise in the constraints they put on our system and very wise about not wanting to bestow that much power in any one person's hands, including the vice president of the United States, who I think would have, obviously, a vested interest in the outcome. And I think, as you've heard him say, you know, he was on the ballot. He wanted a different outcome, too. But to suggest that was a role that he could have had, I think was unfortunately a poor service to the president and some of the advice that he was given. So long story short is that I never was actually banned. I continue to serve out the rest of my time throughout the White House.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Please join me in thanking Marc one more time.